This has really forced me to think. The first thoughts are, okay, failure, yeah, I get that. We learn from failure, right? That's the kind of obvious one, the one that you think, you know, I'm being really insightful in understanding that. But actually, as I've sat down and talked to friends in business, you know, kind of polled people on Facebook, polled people on LinkedIn through my own contacts and got lots of feedback about it, I've had some really interesting responses. And so what I've got for you today is not any answers about what failure is or how I represent failure, although I'll be open with you about how I think I've done a fairly decent job of representing failure at times. This is just about designed to kind of get you to think in slightly different ways about what failure is, what it means to you is ultimately the only thing that's important. So let's get into it. So first of all, a brief introduction to who I am. I'm the chief exec of Retriever New Business, which is a new business agency helping creative businesses find more business, help them sell better, pitch better, all that. And Retriever SP, which is Retriever Sales Performance, which is similar services, but for anyone that's not in the marcoms or marketing services sector. So we work with software companies and whoever else. And Will, I should also mention who I'm with today, is managing director across both of those businesses. I'm also a father of two boys, feral boys, and husband to a mostly very patient wife. And I showed this to Jenny, my wife, last night. I said, what do you feel about me putting the word mostly in there? She agreed, so I kind of kept it in. I probably am a stereotypically stressed salesman. I mean, I am a salesman, and I'm really sorry for that, if that offends anyone. You know, I think we nearly set up, I say we nearly set up in New York. It was kind of a way of me buying flights to New York for me and the family and putting them through the business. But we looked at the States. And what I really liked about the US was the fact that being a salesman over there is really quite a good thing. It's acceptable. It's a career. Whereas still in the UK, I think there's a problem with being a salesman. I don't have a problem being a salesman. I'm very proud of what I've done. You know, I've built a career out of making cold calls, basically, pretty much. Not so much. Don't do quite so much of that these days, but that's pretty much where I've come from. I've always been very protective of the things that I love and the things that I've made and the things that I've built and grown, and possibly I've possibly brought too much of that into business, so that when we don't win a pitch or we don't get appointed by a client, I spend my time trying to work out what the hell's wrong with the person that's making the decision at the other end, and they don't understand why they would use an alternative business, and I've said therefore I suppose I take things personally. So if you want to, you know, look at that from as a failing of mine, I definitely think it would be. I'm not a hard-skinned businessman at all. And that makes it a harder journey, I think, building businesses. I remember 4.5 years ago, it was still just me. I was kind of roving new business problem solver. And I met Will when I had a couple of people. I remember saying to Will, these two people got the business, are absolutely, we could never do without them. Under Will's guidance, about 6 weeks later, they were both gone. But since then, we've built up a company of about 25 people, doing a lot of really good work. But I am very protective of the things that are obvious, like my children, my wife, you know, my friends, but also my team. You know, we've had times where a client's been it's quite difficult if you're in a sales role for another business because you're very exposed. It's like doing new business for an agency. There is always expectation, and therefore there is always this propensity to be seen to be failing most of the time, actually. You know, sort of can't remember the times when I was in my last sales director role at a big agency. You come back from London or wherever you've been with a brief from Carphone Warehouse was the last one I remember bringing back. And, you know, it's all hail the mighty Mark with his brief from Carphone Warehouse. You know, the following week, you haven't really got anything to tell anyone and you're, you know, just sort of sat in the corner again. And that's quite tough. Just out of interest, quick show of hands, who in here is in a sales role of any kind? Yeah, and the rest of you creatives, programmers, coders, but I'll get the wrong language, and children as well, it's perfect, except for a child. Some of the belief success isn't based on money, but on happiness and health. It's a bit sickly, isn't it, to say that? But my own experiences have taught me, and which I will share to some extent with you, the cliche that without health there is nothing has a couple of times become all too real to me. Only in March this year, in fact, I was facing the amputation of my left leg. I went into an operation in France where no one spoke English. I spoke some French, but I'm not sure if I was, you know, ordering a beer or saying take it off above the knee, frankly, half the time. So, you know, we all go through these things, and I get that. For anyone that's interested, it was nothing heroic. I had a blood clot in an artery. So, yeah, I can't claim shark stories, I'm afraid. And I am, of course, like everyone in this room and everyone on this planet, a direct result of my experiences, both good and bad. Retriever, I've explained what we do. So just to recap in terms of actual detail, telemarketing, new business agency, strategy development, and lots of training, lots and lots of training. I trained 150 or so people at Lloyd's Banking Group last year to be more natural, less salesy, more engaging, understand the difference between rapport, understand what a relationship actually is. A relationship isn't actually just talking about what someone did on the weekend. A relationship is actually being able to just be straight with people, and that's very much our mantra. A retriever, which is fueled by our philosophy, which is this thing called Wise Mind. Anyone heard of Wise Mind? No. It's a well-established psychology. Now, I've come in front of quite a bit of psychology for reasons that will be revealed as I progressively take you through my life's work of failings. It's very simple. There's two sides to it. One is emotional, represented by red, and one is rational, represented by blue. And people tend to fall into either of those categories. So who in this room would say they sort of more up the emotional end of the scale? I don't believe that for a second. No one's. I don't want my hand up because I'm emotively that might. So who thinks they're just deeply rational? Okay, so there are hands that I think could have gone up either way there. But there is, generally speaking, people in sales are very emotional, and people who are very calm, collected, and don't get too stressed tend to be rational. And for those, what I learned being a stress head and a very emotional person is that I would spend far too much time in the emotional camp. And that for me to feel good and to not get fits of very nasty anxiety and stress, I need to sort of rationalize what I'm doing. We'll talk more about it, but it's what fuels everything we do. So that we select our team on the basis, we employ our team on the basis that they're great communicators, but also they have a big heart and a big brain, and that'll do. We can kind of train the rest as long as they've got enough experience so they can make sense to people on the phone. I am underselling them a bit there, but it is really important that we find that mix in people. So that's Wise Mind in the middle in purple. So that's kind of, we find when I'm training salespeople, I get to think about balancing rational and emotional. When we're talking to people on the phone, whether we're writing emails, whether you're pitching to people, you've got to balance those two things. Because then people, you know, all people do business with people they like, you know, fact. No one can disprove that. There are millions and millions of people offering services to other companies who are mainly commoditized now, just because there's so many people doing the same things, especially in the creative services world. So standout has to come through personality, is our belief, and it works for us and for our clients. So I'm here today because of failure, and perhaps, or perhaps in spite of failure, I suppose. But I want to look at what failure actually is, and say these aren't answers, these are my thoughts about the subject. So if we look at, does someone feel, you know, you talk, people go, oh God, you know, he's a right failure. Is someone actually a failure, or is it a behavior that's gone wrong that's created a failure? So my eldest son, Eddie, if he takes an exam, he doesn't pass, he's failed. But I'm not about to start calling him a failure. Well, I might do that for fun. But, you know, so I think this comes from, I was discussing today with, amongst other people, a guy called Dr. Martin Haller, who's a clinical psychologist who basically runs psychiatry for Somerset, which I imagine is a fairly challenging job. And this is one of the biggest discrepancies that people find it hard to make, especially if they get depressed or they feel like they're not getting things right or they're failing. And you've only got to start to Google failure and, you know, we're awash with people who are some heroic failures in life, but there's a great many people out there who are pretty down, pretty out, pretty depressed, pretty low, because they feel like a failure. And failure is, I think, and I agree with the fact that it's a behavior that's gone wrong, leading to a fail. And this, of course, moves itself into different environments. So we can look at failure at work, deadlines, our own performance. You know, we're all probably one of our greatest critics. Clients, you know, I mean, I sort of slightly jokingly say, you know, without staff and clients, I'd just be the happiest man, businessman in the world, you know, but life ain't like that. Reporting, you know, making sure your clients know. I mean, I really, when I set Retriever up, I set up a business that was destined, in terms of the daily experience of being in this business, I was destined only to experience 90% of the time failure. Because any of you that do sales, especially what we do, which is doing sales from the coalface, you know, cold new business development, so turning names on a spreadsheet into a paying client or turning it into a meeting for an agency or for whoever else, more than 90% of what you hear every day is no. Even if it's no thank you and it's very charming, it's a nice conversation, it's still no. So in a way, I probably would have thought it through a little better, and it's no surprise to me now that when I say to the kids, you know, should we keep Retriever going? You know, you can come and work there and all the rest of it. Eddie certainly my eldest said, no, you're all right, Dad. Sitting around with a 10-year-old saying one day you'll make cold calls like your father is not a very inspiring careers talk, I've found. So people need to feel very safe in business, and I don't think they often do feel safe enough in business to fail, and to fail often. I suppose it's how you fail, isn't it? If you fail trying, you know, I remember when I lived in South Africa for a year, I tried to learn to surf, and although I'm absolutely hopeless, all the guys sat out on the boards were just, you know, really, really encouraging, because at least you were trying. But, you know, that near-death experience for me, I'm not going to try that again. So the feedback I had from my friend, who is the global head of HR, Thomson Reuters, said, pretty big job, actually, a lot of people that he looks after. His failure for me is failing to learn when you mess up, as you surely will. The people, teams, and organizations I admire the most are those that systematically squeeze every drop of learning from each success and each failure. In that way, they don't fear failure and don't hesitate to take risks, since everything is an opportunity to learn. That feels like, for me, the really safe, really sensible understanding of what failure is. I think that's a really good, solid representation of what failure is and how it can be accepted, how it can be and exist in a big corporate business. Then there is failure at home, which is full of opportunities. DIY, being a parent. I mean, hands up, parents in here. I hope I'm not the only one who feels like this, but how often do you feel, I don't know how to get this right, you know? And your kids are, of course, excellent things. But they do have shut your ears. They have a habit of making you feel like a, you know, medieval torturer at times. I think it's a very hard thing to do, be a parent. I really do. Finances, you know, sort of, you can feel like you're not earning enough, or you're overdrawn again, or you're not quite getting that right. Washing, personal bete noir for me. Not physically, I do wash physically, but clothing. Cleaning, I always pretend I do quite a cracking job around the house of cleaning, but I always know where I clean, because you can see my wife going over the same area almost instantly. I would find that really funny. Dishwasher. I want to talk to you more about dishwashers in a minute, because I think they're a very important part of failure. Very important part. And finding matching socks, which is kind of a no-brainer. So there are lots of things we either haven't done or we've done badly around the house. So just focusing on the dishwasher thing for a minute. This is roughly how I would load a dishwasher. The dog might be the exception, of course, but I'm one of those people that will load a dishwasher on the basis that, well, it's all in there. Some of it might break. Most of it will get clean. And if you're careful, you won't cut yourself when you take everything out. So I'm sort of quite happy with that. I'll sort of mince about the kitchen saying to Jenny, you know, I've done the dishwasher. It's done. She opened the dishwasher. She just start reloading it until we get something that looks a bit more like that. Work with me on this one, but I'm trying to get this kind of emotional, rational balance thing going on again. And, you know, for me, that's Hang on, it's gone a bit funny. So wait a second. For me, that is the sort of perfect balance of rational and emotional. We just have one dishwasher each.
Can you ask, explain things also, like or ask?
What, questions?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, crack on! Yeah, God, absolutely.
My wife does that also, and she calls that washing machine Tetris.
Right.
So, because I think it's a game for her.
Yeah.
Actually, to do fit everything, like organize them, like Tetris goes, everything goes like that.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and I think
it's ridiculous. Yeah, from my point of view.
But I think you know, for me, it's like, you know, this is such a. I'm just trying to, you know, there are different ways to fail, right? And I failed to be able to load a dishwasher. And the other thing about dishwashers, I'd love to know, is are you meant to put wine glasses in them or not? So I've never done that, not broken one of them things. So we've bought stemless wine glasses now. So there we go. Just a ditty about that, and a quote here: DIY has never been a task I would associate with Mark. In fact, it fills me with horror every time he picks up his toolkit. Let's just get a man in to do the job. It's a quote from my long-suffering wife. So I want to look now at just different scales of failure, because this is quite important for perspective and keeping things relative. So the mighty NASA tells us, and has always told us, failure is not an option. And then we see this. And stark is that. And sad as that moment was, I think that represented on a pretty epic level what it was to fail in global proportions. So America, much like the Obama Wall of Justice that's running through Cardiff at the moment, is very good at making the world look at it, and very good at making sure the world looks at its soldiers. It makes films about its soldiers hugging in airports. We don't tend to do that. And so when it comes to a big event in the States, they make sure every camera in the world is facing that way. And of course, when it goes wrong, that's what people remember. And I remember watching this. I was at school and I was sat, you know, we were all allowed to watch the launch of Challenger as a teacher going to space and all the rest of it. And I remember when that happened, we kind of looked at each other and go, I really don't know how to react to that. But no idea what I'm supposed to feel. Because it was such an epic failure. Then we move on to our kids who, you know, we want to stay safe. We want to protect them from any danger we possibly can. We don't want them to pass exams, we don't want them to fail exams, but they will fail exams. They'll fail things constantly, just as we do. We want to stay away from, you know, the wrong crowd, the failures in life. We want them, you know, we're paranoid about the internet, strangers, drugs, and any danger we can think of. A couple of years ago, my kids learned about stranger danger. Anyone else's kids done that yet? Basically, when you're approached by someone with a bag of sweets at the school gates, and it's how you're supposed to react. And my eldest is quite sensible, you know, he's quite a sensible chap. He ran off shouting, stranger danger across the field. And my youngest one just punched me in the balls. And I thought that's a really interesting thought about how they react to the guidance they've had. But Will knows Barney, and he'll know that he is half man, half wild dog. So we want to keep our kids safe, right, all the time. And you turn you back for a second, and there is this Barney, when he was about 1.5, face planting. And I was looking at this picture last night. I was trying to work out how he's managed to face plant that way when the bike's going that way. But it's a physics thing, I think. But so you can't prevent failure, really, at any level, I think. It's always going to happen. We love our pets. You know, we're a nation of pet lovers, aren't we? And then we come home to this. And it's my own kitchen floor, my glass house, after four dogs, which we have. Completely ransacked the bin. I was surprised they didn't even peel the potatoes. They'd gone to that much detail at wrecking the house at that point. So again, you know, relative examples of how failure has its size, its shape, its moment, and its time. So we are surrounded by it in all shapes and sizes. In fact, it's even become a brand that people are fascinated with. You know, it's one in their view. You know, who doesn't like watching fails? You know, maybe it's just me. I've some of the funniest things I've ever seen. You know, what isn't funny about someone cycling down a ramp, coming off their bike and smacking their face really hard on concrete? Why wouldn't you want to watch that? I was recently divorced, lost the little that I had, relatively speaking. And me and Jenny, you know, literally started with NAFL. I'm not going to do a rolling on you, don't worry. But so I know what it's like. I think a lot of us know what it's like to be skinned. But I kind of, I worry about how failure is represented sometimes, but by those with, you know, £4 or 5 billion. It's very easy to talk about your failings, isn't it? When you're completely out of that zone. So anyway, it's sort of become a brand, which is a bit weird, I think. But it also sends a story that failure isn't. It's moved on. You know, the word is not enough, or the word is too much, maybe. And that's where, as you can tell, I've done a lot of thinking about this. I had to. But it's a strange thing. But we do keep on trying, no matter what. And this is the long suffering. This is young. Carry on.
In Finland, there's a company called Supercell that produces mobile games. They've done the heyday of Clash of the Clans.
Oh, right.
And it's a company that's grown like fastest pretty much in the world. And they embrace the failure. Every time they make a failure game, they pop up champagne and just go to the next one. Because industry moves on, that you have to kind of keep on trying to make these games, and one of them becomes a hit.
Yeah.
And it's a
multi-billion
business.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, is it, I think we at Bristol Media, Charlotte, you might remember the figure here, but the guy from Neon Play was talking about Candy Crush. I think that brings net something like $20 million a day, I think. We must write an app well at some point. So anyway, there is Mrs. Young winning the race, the Mother's Day race a few years ago. And the reason I put this picture up there is A, because I just think it's an epic, I'm trying really hard picture. And B, the reason that day, Barney O'Young's son, who is at that age, you know, he only 2 years ago, he would, you know, he's kind of going to get to the start line, starts crying and walks away. And it's just the saddest thing you've ever seen, because all his mates are kind of raring to go. He doesn't want to fail. He never wants to fail. So he just thinks, well, I won't race. Whereas my oldest son will run his little heart out, maybe come second, but did you see that, Dad? Did you see that? Whereas Barney's like, no, do one, mate, I'm off. And this day, I remember Jenny felt so sorry for him. She thought, right, I'm going to run this race, and I'm going to win for Barney. And she did. And I thought that was really sweet. And it's a picture I look at quite often, actually, if I'm feeling like I need a bit of va-va-boom. You think, well, God, if someone could put that much effort into a mother's race, I can probably write this pitch document for said client. That's definitely the wrong way, isn't it? It's a good slide there. So this isn't really about failure, is it? It's about life. It's just life happening. And you frame things the way you want to frame them. You know, you could say, this morning, you know, we were laughing about it because of today, and saying, fail, brilliant, wrong it something, for fail, scratch the car, jolly, and give them a load of I'll talk to him about it later. I can't, some areas of speech now I can't not swear, isn't that interesting? So I feel if I don't have the words, if I can't swear. I haven't sworn once today, which I'm very proud of. So it's about life and it's about business, but everything becomes about context. And the harder you push, sometimes the more it is you're likely to fail, and that's exactly what happened to me. I set Retriever up to improve my lifestyle. It quickly became the only thing I ever did. 10, 12, 14 hours a day, making 400 or 500 cold calls a week, which anyone in your business will know that's a lot of calls. I was looking after new business for about 12 agencies, all of them baying for more all the time. Bear in mind, obviously, 90% of the time I'm spent hearing the word no or no thank you, or not for us, thanks, Ducky. Managing finances really badly, as Will will testify when he came and took that stuff over. Managing clients are probably quite badly. I mean, my way of selling in those days was just a charm offensive. So if it worked, it worked. If it didn't, I moved on, you know. And it works a lot of the time because I was genuine. I didn't try and sell to people. It was just like, look, please like me. I've worked for a good agency. There's got to be something we can do. And it was good. But I was sort of building this incredible head of steam. And actually earning lots of money, and I just thought, like, you know, we've arrived. And there's this one time I remember Jenny, my wife's dad, saying to me, well, don't forget, Mark, you've got to be around to enjoy it. And then about 3 months later, that happened. And I was literally out for the count. I didn't leave our house for 3 months. I could barely string a sentence together. In the words, anyone know Spinal Tap? In the words of Davidson Hubbins, if I hadn't been so heavily sedated, I may have never left the house again. It was awful. And I don't know if any of you have any familiarity with anxiety or Hag Tax will know people that do, but it really is a horrible, horrible thing, and it's all-consuming, it's visceral, it's horrible. And from the time I got together with Jen, when she got very ill with a blood clot in her lungs, got blood clots in the family, it's hard because I was the only person earning the money, and if I didn't earn, I didn't earn. There was no business there to support me, so I was either making calls and earning or I wasn't. And it was the hardest time of my life by a country mile, and I still now manage it. It doesn't go away. You just have to manage it, you know. It's a bit of a slog, and that was a really horrible time. And it was that time and the counselling I got and the way I recovered that made me realise there was a much better way to do what we do. And that's where Wise Mind, Rational Emotional Balance came from. There is another thing I've been working on around compassion of mine, which is brilliant as well, but I'm afraid it's not yet gone in the oven, so I can't exactly talk about it today. But so getting back on my feet was pretty hellish. Actually, drugs, not good ones, lots of them, lots of counselling. Sleep and water, I cannot recommend highly enough to anyone that wants to avoid getting stressed out. They're the most remarkable things. Patience and determination, I think, you know, certainly the roughest and hardest thing I've ever had to do. And accepting that I had, you know, my problem was that I felt that I was failing on so well. I was being driven into the ground in so many ways. So you feel like I'm failing. And eventually you do, it just goes pop. You can't process that amount of negativity. Finally, I want to talk a little bit about the, it's a bit where I might look quite intelligent actually, the physiology of failure. Anyone know about the reward system in the brain? Yeah. So the reward system is the thing that we like to get a good bolt of dopamine out of when something good happens. So if we hear that we won a pitch, or you know that person we fancy sends us a text, that hasn't happened to me for a very long time. It's that shot of dopamine, and this region of the brain here, the accumbens, the amygdala and the hippocampus. The amygdala is the bit of your brain which holds all the primeval fight or flight stuff that we had since we were cavemen. And people that get anxiety and panic, this is where it roots from. And this is also the bit that you can complement and feed with really good things. Thing is, that dopamine hit, you can go out and look, you might get it very occasionally. I think that's the way your life is, something very occasionally happens, it's amazing. And we all want that, but the more dopamine you want, the more of that high that you want, the more you've got to go at things, you've got to strive constantly. Therefore, by definition, the more you're going to fail. So it becomes a trade-off, bluntly, between how hard you're going to push everything that you do as to how hard you're going to try and, as to how much you will fail. And I think, you know, I'll just end on some advice I was given, and it sort of seems really relevant again with the, I'm not about to do an ice bucket challenge, by the way. It sort of seems relevant with all that ALS stuff going on. Great, well, someone like my surrogate mum, my parents were a bit rubbish actually, yours are wonderful, I'm sure. And I kind of grew up with a lovely old Welsh bloke called Ron Evans, and his wife Brenda Evans. She, is that a barber, do you think? Come in, do you read me? As she died of motor neuron disease, she got motor neuron disease, and she hated it, and she was a very much a performer. Ron was an opera singer from the Valleys. She was a kind of cabaret and singer. And I remember when she was really going downhill with it, she said to me, Mark asked, which she, I don't know what she called me, she didn't call me that. She said, I must tell you, I'm going to kill myself. And I said, Brenda, sorry, come again, what would you say? We kill ourselves, but I want to get organized here. So I'm going to write a list of all these things. Who's going to speak at the funeral? Who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? And it was absolutely hideous thing to go through. But one thing Brenda did say to me, and I'm going to pass this on to all of you as my final statement, really, is to strive always, to fail, and fail comfortably. Stay wise. Bear in mind that wise mind, it does work. Look it up. And never, ever stop. Never stop. Stopping is pretty permanent, I think, if it happens. And that's it from me. So I welcome any questions you may have.
I think from your experience, do you recognise people heading for that kind of failure or whatever sort? Do you just stress or burn?
Yeah, I think you can see it. I think,
do you see it more readily?
Oh yeah, my aerials are pretty sharp to it. I mean, especially running a team of salespeople.
Yeah.
You know, you can see when they're getting a bit twisted sometimes, and you know, we'll do everything we can to kind of. I run a surgery thing on a Thursday morning where they can come and kind of just vent spleen or moan or just talk about the price of fish or say, can I borrow some money? So my car's broken, I can't fix it, whatever. But you can see it. I want to see it in my own family and see it in my wife. I know far too many people that suffer with stress and anxiety.
Has it helped you because you obviously have a range of things that you can sort of.
Yeah, I mean, the route I've taken is, so I suppose generalized counseling, like cognitive behavioral therapy, which is incredibly good for dealing with, the kind of behaviors around anxiety. I'm just holding something. And then there's the more clinical stuff, which I've worked on, like Wise Mind and the Compassionate Mind that I'm working on now and stuff like that. And I've really loved it. It's turned into a real passion. I know if I wasn't a retriever, I would definitely train to be some sort of counselor. Because the more you know, the less you realise you're qualified to counsel people. You can give friends advice, and I do see it. I do see people going down that road, and you feel that you can do something to help it, but you must never doing this and going through a lot of the thought process I went through to do this, sort of dredged up some quite uncomfortable stuff that I didn't really like thinking about. So it's sort of always there. It's just you either water the good plant or the bad plant. Best advice, ignore the bad plant, what's the good one? So, and then many other riddles available at retrievingbusiness.co.uk. So yeah, I think you can.
Anybody else got any questions?
What do you think the fear of failure stands for?
It's a good question, isn't it? I don't know. Can't possibly know the answer, I think, otherwise I'd be very famous and very rich. So I can only say for me, the fear of failure stems from the responsibilities that I have in my, I have 25 staff that need to pay their bills. I have family that needs to eat. I have my own set parameters about what I want to achieve. And I still don't know what they look like. So I think it's a very, very personal thing. I mean, I always wanted to rent surfboards on a beach. That's all I wanted to do. And I'm quite sure if I'd done that, I wouldn't be here or capable of or knowledgeable enough to talk about anything particularly. But I'd probably be very relaxed, very happy, very tanned. It just depends, what you're going to do with your life and how you gauge the fear factor. I mean, clinically, the fear comes from the amygdala, which is the thing I showed you. That's where cavemen knew whether to club, cuddle, burn, or eat, basically. Things. It's a very instinctive thing, and that hasn't gone away from anyone, any one of us. There are techniques they use to kind of tap into those parts of the brain, but it's down to you. If I think of it, I'll definitely let you know.
Well, I think a strive for perfection is a kind of a big part of it. So not perfection in the classic sense, but like Barney's race, like the outcomes first or anything at all. So do you think that was part of what you went through, that you worked in those many hours and always trying to be? Because my wife, she went through a lot of counselling.
That's very funny.
And it was a lot of talk of, well, you were always striving for this perfection, this, and I look after my daughter the best way I can. Do you think that's part of it? Or do you think it was more a level of success that you wanted to get to?
No, I think it was. It's the former. I mean, I don't see my being a perfectionist is such an incredibly dangerous thing to be. It's clinically dangerous to be perfectionist because it's harder to get the dopamine hits and get some distance between you and failure. Because if you're constantly trying to perfect things, I think for me the challenge then was about the fun of earning money. I don't do some money as a sales director in agencies, but the fun of doing less hours and earning the same if not more money. But then I think I wouldn't get too deep into this, but there are reasons through my growing up that I've wanted to prove myself to be successful. And I think those are the real drivers. Those are the real drivers. And wanting to, I don't know what it looks like. I can't, my mum's an absolute cat. Oh, Poppy, you've done so well. 25 people, it's amazing. All this. And so to me, that isn't the definition of success or having not failed. You know, I mean, me and Jenna would say, you know, if it all went wrong, you know, we'd happily just like live in a little tiny house, work in a pub, and I suspect we would just do that. And so I don't think it's about money for me. It's handy to earn some money, obviously. But we can't define what we're doing, otherwise, you know, you lose the happiness bit. If you lose the happiness bit, money stops you anyway. Any other questions? I bid you farewell, my friends.
Just want to say thanks again to Mark for taking the chance on us, really, and found that really fascinating. I hope you all did as well. Next month's theme is colour, and Alex Jenkins coming to talk for us, so looking forward to that. Hopefully, next month will be slightly less crazy than this one. But it's all come together really well. Really enjoyed it. So thank you very much.